Hey, welcome to another episode of Technical Difficulties. I'm your host, Pete. We got Brandon. We've got some guy in glasses today. It's Vince. Oh, Vince, he's wearing the sunglasses in night. We've got a fun episode today. We got a special guest with us. We're talking about aging in place, and I'm really excited to tell you who's going to be here. But first, I want to thank our sponsor, Zeus. The Zeus Black Friday Cyber Monday Mega Sale at the Smartest House is going on right now. This is the big one, people. If you watch our show, you know that Zeus makes some of the best Z-Wave devices on the market and has perhaps the widest range of Z-Wave products you can find. I'm talking switches, dimmers, plugs, relays, and all sorts of sensors to keep your house safe and automated. And right now, you can find mega savings on some of their most popular products. The Zen 74 dimmer and Zen 30 double switch are both under $20. That's 50% off. The ZSE 70 Z-Wave long-range outdoor motion sensor is $18 off. And if you want the Zeus multi-relay to automate your garage door, you can save $18 right now. And the Zeus Z-Box Hub, is only $79.95, and that is $60 off the regular price. Now, not only that, if you order $69 worth of stuff, you'll get free shipping in the continental United States. My apologies to our thousands of fans in Hawaii and Alaska, but you live in Hawaii and Alaska, so I don't feel that bad for you. All right. The Zeus Mega Sale ends at midnight on December 12th. So hurry up. Go to thesmartesthouse.com to buy all of your gifts for your family, your friends, your grandparents. I'm sure your kid's teacher might want a Zeus relay of some sort. My wife is really excited to get a DC motor controller. Yeah, great gift for your whole family. So pick it up right now at thesmartesthouse.com. And thank you, Zeus, for your sponsorship of our show. And let's introduce our special guest. He's actually a big Zeus fan, and he's the former host of the show. Please welcome, everybody, the former original DIY Smart Home Guy, John Stone.
I prefer OG.
Yeah, OG. OG, all right. DIY Smart Home Guy.
No, I mean, like OG, it's him.
Yes, that's better. I thinks he's still calling the shots around here, I guess. Call him whatever he wants to. But
I don't even call shots in my own home, Pete. Come on.
Well, thank you for joining us, John. You're coming from your new house, I see. So yeah. You got that all smartened up at this point.
Living La Vida Vegas, baby. Yeah.
Yeah. So what have you been up to since you handed the reins over to me?
Well, yeah. So we moved in the new house. It's been a while back now, and it required a lot of renovation. And I promised my wife that it would all be done in 6 to 8 months. That was roughly 3.5 years ago. we're about halfway done. Taking a little bit more time than we thought, but I've actually been able to go through on the smart home side, and I'd say consolidate things. You know what it's like. You do the smart home channel, so you get all sorts of stuff to test all the time, and your house is basically a rainbow of products, and nothing's the same. I don't have that problem since I don't do the channel anymore. So I've standardized basically everything throughout the house, and I love it. I love all the choices that I've made. They've been hanging out with me now for years, and I do small tweaks and small updates here and there. But for the most part, I would say it's smart home stable. My hub is stable because of that. I'm not changing things all the time, so my automations just work. So it's really nice.
My wife would definitely appreciate that. She gets a little annoyed sometimes with all the, why is my light not working today? Oh, I'm testing something. Don't worry about it. Sometimes I'm not testing something. It's just broken. I don't want to get mad at me. So
the viewers need to know, what hub did you go with?
I'm all on Hubitat. I'm on the C8 Pro. I'm doing two C8 Pro hubs. I don't know that I made the right choice, but I have one is just a Z-Wave controller. One is just a Zigbee controller. And the one that is the Zigbee controller also does all of the automations and dashboards. I don't know if that was smart or not, but that's what I did. And it works great. I mean, I'm constantly amazed now that I made some changes in my motion detectors. I upgraded from the previous generation of Zeus motion detectors into the new generation of Zeus motion detectors. They're all hard powered now, and everything's lightning fast. My batteries don't die. The automations just work. So it's been really good.
And did you switch them all over to the Zeus or to the Z-Wave long range, the Zeus devices, or are you still running them on regular Z-Wave?
Z-Wave LR powered all the time.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. I'm a big fan of the long range. That seems to be work very well. And
what about switches?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So I'm half in a Veli and half Zoos on the switches. So every room in the house has a set of four floodlights. They're dimmable floods. I converted all of those over to low wattage color tunable LED. Mm-hmm. And all of those switches are the Inveli red and or blue series that have the nice little level indicator for mm-hmm. what the dim level is. And so that's any room where you see that switch, it means you have dimmable lights. And then all of the fan lights, I have ceiling fans in almost every room. So anything that's non-dimmable, essentially I'm using the Zoos products on. And then in the bathroom fans, I'm using the double switch. And I'm using the paddle as basically the control, and then it controls mm-hmm. the relay side. So you get some on-off control there, but the load itself is being controlled by the relay side of the double switch. And then all the bathrooms and laundry rooms all have the, again, it's the same motion / multi-sensor that's got the humidity detection in it. And all the fans operate automatically with the humidity levels, which I think Pete did a video on how to do that.
Yep.
I did mine before Pete did his video.
I was still at Hubitat at the time.
But he told you how to do it correctly. That's nice. All the fans. I actually had to rewire a few of the ceiling fans to get them to be able to be controlled with the GE fan switch instead of having to use the remote all the time. Mm-hmm. Except for one fan, which then I put in the Bond integration. So I'm able to control that from Pico's using Bond. Almost everything that I want to use the Bond for, I can, except for a humidifier. And I have one light in my bar that I wish I could. It needs a remote, but the Bond won't work with it.
I did want to ask you about the bar. That's all set and ready to go.
Yeah, the bar's done. It's looking lived in.
Nice.
Fully stocked and ready for us to visit. Perfect.
That's right.
Come on. We can do a podcast episode out of the bar.
Yep. We need to re-up our sponsorship.
That's it. All right. Yeah, Zeus, come on. We got a whole another season. We can go to John's bar. It'll be fantastic. So but yeah, it's great. It's great to see you again, John. Haven't had you on the show for a while. You did your scuba video, which was fun to for that, but love to chat with you. You're very knowledgeable about the smart home, and like I said, today our main topic is we're talking about aging in place, and I want to bring John on the show specifically for this episode because he's old. Yes, you're one of the oldest people I know.
And John, aging in place, what do you get?
Call John immediately. Yeah, no, but I do know you have told me that you have helped your parents out in this situation. Obviously they're older than you, and I hope that's generally how biology works as far as I understand it.
They identify as younger than me though.
I'm sure they do. But yeah, I want to just kind of talk about maybe some of the things that you've done to make it easier for your parents to stay there and easier for you to check on them, right? To make sure they're healthy and safe. And I got you know, two parents of my own that they're getting older. They will live in their house forever, I'm sure. And yeah, so I want to make sure that they're safe. And my mother-in-law, she watches every episode. I don't know why, because it's like a foreign language to her, I'm sure, with the smart home thing. But thank you for watching. But we want to keep you safe. You're very sweet. And we want to make sure everything's great for people that are staying in the house. So, John, can you tell me off the top, what are some of the biggest things you should do if you want to stay in your house until you die?
Stay alive.
Young? Is that what?
Yeah, well, eat healthy, eat right, lots of fiber, you know, all that stuff that they tell you to do, you should do.
Okay, let's go with the smart home realm.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, so I would say at the highest level, you'd break it down into three categories. And for your parents themselves, you want to be thinking about safety and security. And then there's going to be an aspect to it where you're going to want monitoring, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm in a very lucky situation right now where my parents really like the smart home stuff. And they don't want me to monitor them, but I'm guiding them in the direction of all the smart home stuff so that when that day comes, it's going to be very easy to do, right?
Yep.
So, you know, safety side, and I would say a lot of my list, when I was really thinking about this, it doesn't matter really, I think, if you're just getting into smart home or getting into smart home because you're looking at aging in place. Garage door opener, you know, something where you can make sure that that garage door alerts you if it was left open. My memory is not good. My parents' memory is better than mine. But, you know, making sure that garage door is closed, I think, is something good. And then if you have something that's app controlled, that's where you get into that monitoring. So you can actually be included on that. It also gives you a way to ingress the house if you need to in an emergency. You know, so garage door opener, I would say, is like number one on my list. Number two is going to be probably the smart thermostat, specifically the Ecobee, because you can put in the room sensors, and those room sensors give you a sense of occupancy. So not only does it help them be comfortable in the house, but you also have that monitoring side for the, are they the present sensing, right? So that gives you another window in without being there. You can see, hey, the room's occupied. Hey, they're moving around. I think motion sensors, MMWave would be the best. But, you know, if you can't go MMWave, I would definitely get into motion sensors. But I would say, just like I was talking about at the top, if you can keep those hardwired, that's also a good idea because you don't want to have to change batteries. And that, you know, you can get a sense of where they're moving around the house if they're moving. You know, you could go down the list, but another one that I think is important would then be a voice assistant that has the ability to do 911 dialing. This is the new help, I've fallen and I can't get up. If they're in voice range of a voice assistant, then they can call 911 if they've fallen. And that's really one of the big scares, I would say, with aging in place is somebody falls and, you know, you hear the stories all the time. They found them 1, 2, 3 days later.
For sure. Yeah.
So, you know, those are the big things.
Unfortunately, I encountered that in my line of work. So it's not a fun situation.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the garage door is a big one. And I think also, I think locks are just as important. You know, having some sort of a combination lock, because not only is it good to make sure they're locking the door every night automatically, but like as you get older, you may have people coming in and out of your house helping you out, right? And you don't want to give them your main code to the house to let them in. But if you give them a temporary code for them to come in and do what they need to do, and I think that makes a lot of sense.
Oh yeah. We just had an estate sale where we were meeting with the children, and they had the keys that were provided to them, and they handed one over to put in the lockbox. And I was like, hey, this key doesn't work. Then we determined that none of the keys they had actually worked. So had there been a real emergency, they wouldn't have been able to get into this person's house. And so I was like, well, here's another point for having a smart lock and having backup. So it was a single point of entry for that house too. So they would have had to have broken down that door.
I was going to switch Tavis back to the sensor thing. Like those SP2 sensors from Akara also have, you can mount them on the ceiling where you can detect falls as well to be alerted with those ones.
Yeah, no, exactly. I think those are all those are good ideas. Yeah. I was going to say on the smart lock, if you have a single point of entry, go with the keyed lock. If you only have one way in, go with the keyed lock and make sure that you have the key. Or a key, but you want that backup. If the single point of entry, always get a smart lock that has keys. You don't want those batteries dying and then you have no way in.
All right. Cause they're probably not going to be great about changing the batteries.
you're going to need to monitor.
Yeah, absolutely. So, okay. You said your parents have not allowed monitoring, and I get that. They don't want cameras in their house probably for you to check up on them, and I'm sure you don't want to monitor them in that extent either. Right. I don't necessarily need to go know what's going on in my parents' house, but, would they, have you done anything where it's like, okay, you have some sensors in their house. If they it hasn't detected motion for like a day, will they allow you to get a notification just for that? To say, hey, call your parents to
not yet. No, but my parents are actually, even though they're older than me, at least we think they, they're still very active and very alert. So they're just, I would say I'm not worried about it because they're not really at that state yet, where we're having the problem. You know, they're driving, they both still go over the speed limit on the freeway. So
excellent.
So yeah, so that to me, honestly, everybody says, well, how are they doing? I'm like, they speed on the freeway. I think that means they're doing pretty good. That's my judge now, is driving. How are you driving?
I like that. I like that a lot. So for someone that wants to have some remote access, now I think, so I've my parents have a Hubitat at their house to automate some things. I'm not monitoring them yet at all, but I certainly can. Right?
That they know.
Well, that was my next point is, John, are you doing all the automating and the programming of their home, or are they actually handling some of that?
My dad is doing all of it alone. Every now and again, he calls for help putting in a switch or an outlet or something, but they were running Wink until Wink did whatever Wink did. And then my dad converted himself over to TP-Link CASA or CASA, whatever it is. So he's got about 10 devices in there and he's running the CASA app, and which is actually good for me because all I would have to do is say, hey, give me your access to your CASA app when we ever get to that point.
Wow. Was he a programmer, developer type in his former life? Or
yeah, he was basically a CIO for the state of Oregon. Chief Information Officer, did all the computer systems and stuff back in the day.
Okay, so he knows a thing or two. I would say he would be in the minority of people his age being able to handle a robust hub.
Yeah, 2 or 3 years ago, I think it's still up on the channel. I did an interview with him in the house. And I don't know, it's like a 20-minute interview. And it's a fun watch. I still like to go back and watch it because it just kind of shows how much smarter than me my dad is.
I have with Amazon Echo, where you can sense if there hasn't been any activity in my mom's house, it'll send me an alert or a notification. And that's directly through Amazon. I don't know if they have that anymore. I haven't gotten an alert in a while, but I know it was part of their guard program that they have been kind of chopping away at over the last 6-8 months. But
so what about things like lighting and different automation like that? I mean, have you added lights to make or help them?
I've helped them. And again, my dad's done a lot on his own, but that's another good one in the lighting category. Again, it's the same stuff that I would do in my own house. When you get up in the middle of the night and the motion senses you, then you want to turn some lights on in dim so you don't blind anything. They've added lighting to all of their cabinets, and it's all smart lighting. It's not through TP-Link, but they've put in like just switches on the doors. When you open up the door, it automatically turns on the lights and stuff like that, which is fine. It's instantaneous. They like it that way. But yeah, lighting is another one. With the TP-Link, they're specifically turning on porch lights and garage carriage lights, at a certain time of day, and they're doing all the sunset following stuff with the lights and turning them all off at night automatically, which I also think is great from a security standpoint and just peace of mind.
Yeah, so that's all I've added to my parents' house so far is I've added some lights and they got some shades coming. I'm going to help with that, but my dad loves to play around with the app and change the colors on the lights, but I did automate it, so their outdoor lights are turned on and turned off, and I do want to get them a smart lock. Brandon, I have a question for you, and Vince, for you as well. Not for you, John, because you don't have grass, but is a robot lawnmower, is that a good can someone who is no longer able to mow the lawn themselves, can they use a robot lawnmower, or is there too much maintenance and things that need to get done that's not gonna be helpful and they should hire a lawn service anyways?
I would still recommend just hiring somebody because it's always getting stuck or something weird happens, so, and then you got to deal with the trimming anyways.
I feel like it's not there yet. Maybe in the future here, once the technology gets honed in a little bit, but I think right now, it's probably not probably the best.
Okay. What about robot vacuums? Are they...
They're definitely there. Just get something with self-emptying. I think that's really helpful.
John can answer that question. I think he's got a floor in his house still, even though he lives in the desert.
I do have a floor, but I don't have a robot vacuum yet. My wife finds mopping the floor by hand to be very therapeutic.
Okay.
Send her over.
Yeah, she's welcome anytime.
Yeah, I have noted that it's therapeutic when I've done something wrong.
She pulls out the mop and you leave how leave the house.
And she just mops everything and she's done. And then when she's done, she's happy again. I'm like, she's just whatever. She doesn't want to get angry at me. She mops the floor.
It's your cue to get out.
I go hide in the other room.
So some, is there, if like the floors are dirty, do you just like intentionally make her angry because you know she's going to go?
I just put on my mud shoes and walked from the garage to the backyard and we're done.
Yeah, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. So,
checking to see if I'm getting the look.
What's that?
Just checking to see if I'm getting the look.
Still watch it later.
She's not listening. She's not listening. She'll never listen. We know this. We know this. Women don't seem to, except for my mother-in-law. Thank you for watching. But we get
that's the 1%.
You're alienating the demographic, Pete.
that's the 1%. No, I do want to make a video about how to get women to like home automation, but I haven't figured out how to make that happen. So it seems like a good video idea, but I don't have any ideas for how to get them to like it.
Make it work seamlessly.
Make it seamless. Yeah, we just need to make home automation seamless. And that's, again, when you're getting to talk about someone older that's not a former technology wizard like your dad, right? You got to make it seamless and easy for it to really work. So, you definitely don't want to complicate things too much. Keep all the automations as simple as possible. And the other thing is, like, make sure the switches still work. Make sure they have a way to manually do everything, right? Because they're not, again, your dad, notwithstanding, John, they're not going to be able to figure out what happened if something goes weird. So make sure they have a way.
Yeah, well, that's why I think it was great that, like, in all those closets and alcoves and things where they're opening doors and they want the lights to come on, that's all manual stuff. There's nothing about that that requires a hub. And so it literally does just work every time.
Oh, so you wired an actual contact to the switch? Oh, nice. Yeah.
I wish I could say I did. My dad did.
Your dad did. Okay.
You know, but it's all just there and it all just works. So there's no hub latency. There's no phone call. It takes 3 seconds to come on. And you're like, well, the hub's probably busy doing what hubs do. I don't know what your hub's doing. you know, so, you know, I'd say keep the automation simple, dumb it down, make sure it's always reliable. But that's why I'd say try not to use anything battery, you know, unless you're over there every week checking batteries. But
I think earlier we hit on some good stuff that, like, you know, people don't want to be monitored with cameras, but by using sensors, you can kind of do some of that same thing, like whether it's a millimeter wave or just simply occupancy. And really, we're looking for patterns and, like, when those patterns stop so that, like, you get an alert.
Right.
So whether you've got, like, a sense energy meter and, like, hey, the oven got left on, or hey, we haven't seen any activity in a while, like, that's problematic. Or you have the occupancy sensors, or even having simple, like, flood sensors so that if there's an issue, it, like, turns a water valve off. That's, and that can save a lot of money. Everyone should do that, but I think seniors really gives them good peace of mind.
Yeah,
I think, like I said, at some point I will just put, like, some motion sensors in, like, the kitchen and, you know, maybe the family room. And if, like, that doesn't get activated within a certain amount of time, it'll just send me a notification to, like Vince said, you'll get a notification if it's not active and, you know, something weird is going on. Maybe they just took all the money,
took a nap,
went to Florida and are abandoning you, which is
took a cruise.
Never ending cruise.
They take cruises
for 4 years.
Yep.
They're professional cruisers now. Yeah.
Heck yeah.
Hey, Brandon just went on a cruise. Vince was going to go on a cruise and didn't. So
I've been on plenty.
We're getting
that's
the cruise
got,
age.
That's why I got the sunglasses for the cruise on that I'm missing.
Why do you have the sunglasses, yeah, Vince?
Well, I was debating whether to be on the show today, but I actually have a double eye infection with, like, I don't know, like, pink eye, but it is terrible. I don't even want to take off my glasses because they are.
I don't want you to take off your glasses.
They have all seen it, and it's really bad. It's like, oh, that's enough.
Oh, thanks for fighting the good fight, Vince, and powering through your eyeball.
There's one of Jeff's favorite comedians does a bit about pink eye. Jeff Dunham does a bit on pink eye. That's actually
so one of Jeff's favorite comedians. I'm like, who's Jeff?
Not Jeff. I'm sorry, Pete's favorite comedian.
One of my Dunham and I are not a huge fan of Dunham, but he's very popular.
Don't unsubscribe, Mr. Dunham. The rest of us.
I know. Apologies. Yes.
True.
I'm sure he's a big watcher. He was gonna hire me for his next gig, and now he's not gonna because I said I wasn't a big fan.
You'd open for him, you know you would. Come on.
Oh, I totally would. Are you kidding me? Of course I would. course they would. But I tell him how great he is. It'd be amazing. Oh, you're one of my favorites. I've been watching you for years. So good. So good. By the way, I will do a short plug right now. December 28th at the Turtles in Shakopee. I'm doing my annual Shakopee show. So everybody who lives in Minnesota, come check that out. I'll put a link in the description for that. Awesome. So it's like $15 or something to come see me.
I think I'll
and
go.
Three of my friends. Yeah.
I went last year.
Vince.
Me and Brandon will there. Go.
And John's going to be there. He's flying in for it. It's going to be awesome. Thanks. For
I even brought friends. For like, that's how much of a supporter I am. Yeah. I suckered other people into it.
Yeah, so it should be a lot of fun. Looking forward to that. That's my favorite show of the year always. So please come, just because it's in my hometown. It's a good time. So it's loose. I have a good time. But yeah, I do comedy, by the way. You can't tell from the lack of humor I'm possessing here today on the podcast. But yeah, I do stand-up comedy. It's more prepared than this material. So
it's more stand-up than it is comedy.
Hey.
there was some standing. We did see standing.
All right, I'm sitting in a stool this whole time this year on this show now, just to spite you, John. There'll be no standing, sitting and telling jokes, not dad jokes, jokes about being a dad. Need to clarify that for some people. So, yeah, but it'll be a good time. So, and speaking of good time, I'm going to shift gears now. It's official time to shift gears. I'm going to talk about one issue I had with a lock. My Lockley. Visage, right? The Lockley Visage.
Hey, your favorite lock of all time.
It is. It's my favorite lock. It is my favorite lock of all time. The one negative thing I had to say about it was that the contact sensor in the door is super ugly. And it is super ugly, you guys. It's it's like this nice looking lock that has a cheap plastic contact sensor you have to stick on. It looks ugly. But what I didn't realize at the time, and I apologize for not saying it, is that they have this smart, it's not in focus, but a deadbolt that does a smart deadbolt that you can actually add to your lock. And it has a contact sensor built into the strike plate, or a magnet built in the strike plate. So it actually has a little wire. You wire it into the old. It's completely hidden, seamless. My apologies that I didn't mention it, didn't know about it. I'm going to put a note in the video about that. But I'm excited to test this out. I'll be putting this in soon. But yeah, that seems to solve the only problem I had with the lock, so I'm very excited. And you guys, Vince and Brandon, are going to be helping me out. We're doing a big lock comparison review video coming up. The Visage is going to be in there. We've got a whole bunch of other brands. But it's going to be big. We got at least 16 locks. I built this little rig here. We're going to have all the locks going on at one time. So my handiwork. Right there. So yeah, I'm excited. So check that out coming soon. And I will also give this bit of advice. If you're going to drill 16 holes for locks through a board, don't buy the cheapest hole saw you can possibly find, or it's going to take you hours, literally hours, to drill all these stupid holes. I couldn't believe how long it took to drill these holes. I got through like one hole per battery.
I would like to know the count of how many times you hit yourself with a drill when it got stuck in the wood, and then the drill came around and swung around and hit you. How many times? I want to know.
That would have happened. Fortunately, since I was building in a rig and not in the door, it was pointing down, so it wasn't like banging me in the head. But yes, it did just stop.
I think you just need a better drill.
No. The drill's good. It's a rigid. It's a nice. I like my drills.
Rigid.
I did not hear Milwaukee, so therefore,
or
inadequate.
Listen, Bosch or Makita.
I'm not saying it's the best drill. It's a nice drill. All right. It's a good. It has never had problems. It's on. It's the drill bit. All right. I think
you've never put it to work. All right.
I built a deck. I built a freaking deck with my drill. I built a bathroom in the basement with the drill. It's my baby now. We serve me well.
I want video proof of that second one.
That's true.
Of the bathroom?
With the drill.
Did you at least record yourself doing drilling the holes?
I built a bathroom with a drill.
I mean, I had to frame though. I framed the thing up. I framed it, is what I'm saying. I just screw all the studs in and all the drywall screws. All the drill, baby.
You forgot to mention it's unfinished. Because he only has
it
drone.
Looks amazing. It looks amazing as long as you don't get inside. Yeah.
Brandon, aren't you getting a bidet toilet? I think I saw. Smart bidet toilet.
You know, we get all these CES emails, so I forwarded one onwards as a discount on bidet toilet. So that's his jam. Every time I see a bidet, I think of Vince now.
I don't want to run the power there. I don't want to deal with all the that level of renovation.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah, to put a bidet in, I have to install an outlet, and there's not a convenient way to get a power to where I need to get it, so I have to like bash through drywall and stuff. So we'll see if it's ever worth the effort. But I'm intrigued.
Is there any projects, John, that you're working on or your parents are working on that you're trying to do next for smart home stuff?
Not for my parents. All the projects in my smart home now are these subtle little tweaks that I'm doing. Using Rule Machine because again I'm Hubitat. I just did one where I integrated the weather service into the smart home, and I monitor the outside temperature. And if the outside temperature drops below a certain amount, then it automatically changes the offset in my Ecobee. So I don't have to touch my Ecobee. It just knows if I'm summer mode or winter mode based on the outside temperature, which is great in spring and fall, because sometimes at night it dips down and you want the heater, and then during the day it heats up and you want the air conditioner, and just your default settings are not going to keep you at 72. Not the way Brandon has his thermostat set up.
Well, he sets his to like 100.
72 every day.
72 all day.
But, you know, you got to do that. You got to do that offset change because you're either trying to cool it to 72 or heat it to 72. So that's this automation actually does that. So we keep ours at 76 or 77, depending.
It's too hot.
It's 110 here in the summer. That's actually cold for us. It just keeps it at 76 all day, every day. And it just does it automatically by sensing the outside. So it's just tweaks like that. But it's a big rule. That's big rule. It took several weeks to get it tweaked in just right. But now it's, you know, on the app, and I just set three parameters and it's automatic.
So a lot of what you're doing more hardware or software based versus hardware.
Yeah. Now it's just tweaking in the automations, you know?
So John, do you have any automations that you have tried mightily to get to work and figure out, and you just still to this day can't quite get it right?
Oh, anything illuminance related. You know, getting the house at the right light level based on the illumination sensors and sunlight and clouds is the bane of my existence. I'm still trying. That's been 3 years and I still don't have it right. And I have an off switch.
Stuff I've tried with illuminance, I've always used the sensor in the room, and it's hard to find what that number is. But Vince uses the illuminance on an outdoor one just to kind of a general luminous, but I found actually I haven't tried it yet, but that seems like that might actually make more sense and work better than trying to get the luminance in the room.
Yeah. So the biggest problem I have with the luminance in the room is the lights come on and it says I have enough light, so it turns the lights off.
Yes. You're
trying to get the right level in those little sine waves. I've tried the outside, but then sometimes the blinds are closed and they close, you know, when they open and close automatically, and it's just
my outdoor, I had the new Zeus outdoor motion sensor with the illuminance, and I use it for my blinds. You know, there's a blueprint inside Home Assistant where it'll shut the blinds based on where the sun is in the sky, and so it'll keep it open as much as it needs to, so there's not a where sun is coming in the house and in your eyes. So why I use illuminance. If it's over, I have it set for over 8,000 lumens, then it'll run the automation. If not, then it'll stop. But and it works okay.
Looks like I'm buying a new Zeus.
Yeah. They're really sweet. And they work. And you can hook those up and hardwire those as well. Just like your.
Yeah, I had the last version of it at the old house and loved it. Loved it. Loved it. Loved it.
But I like your thermostat automation too. That seems like a good idea.
Yeah. Yeah. I keep thinking I should give it over to Pete and put it up on the website. I think that'd be a fun one.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's That'd be cool. And like, honestly, the way you set up that dashboard, like you said, I've never heard of anyone doing it like that. I could not explain that without a full walkthrough from you again. But yeah, if we wanted to do something with that, possibly. So by the way, John, have you tried the new Hubitat dashboard? I'm guessing not. You probably spent so much time on the classic dashboard, but have you tried the drag and drop dashboard?
I have. I kind of like it.
I mean, for what you're doing, it's going to be too limited.
It's got a few bugs, and sorry, Bobby, I've been too lazy to go in and write up the bug. But it has a few bugs, but the first thing it did was it broke. I did that video on making your Hubitat dashboards drag and drop.
Yep.
And this new drag and drop feature broke that feature. So, and that feature was actually more powerful than the Hubitat drag and drop. But there is drag and drop there, and I do appreciate it. But it's still a little bit buggy, but it's better than not having the feature at all.
Yeah.
So that's what I would say about it. But I do use it, and I do appreciate it. It just needs a little love. It needs a little more love.
So, well, John, thank you so much for joining us today. And thanks, Vince and Brandon, always for being on the show. Hope you guys at home had a good time. Be sure to give us a like, subscribe, do all those sorts of things. And we'll see you when we have our podcast in John's bar in Vegas.
And I want to say it again. You guys are doing a great job. I'm proud of the way you guys have inherited the channel and taken it over. So appreciate it.
Thanks, John. I do appreciate that. That's the OG John Stone, everybody. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.